Now let me introduce the panel to you. We have with us Abina Hair, transgender activist, iTech India, Vithika Yadav, country head, Love Matters. We have Shireen Jijiboy, director, Aksha Center for Equity and Wellbeing, also Vice President, International Union for the Scientific Study of Population, and board member, Plan India, Disha Shetty, founder, She Says, and we have Prince Manvendra Gohil also joining us today. Thank you all for joining us. Vithika, agar main sabse pehle aapse puchu, kya aapko lagta hai ki, you know, 21st century ki jo life skills mein sex education ko hame shamil karna chahiye, kya ye available hona chahiye bachcho ke liye?
तो सबसे पहले ये चीज है कि हमारी हम 21st सेंचुरी लाइफ स्किल्स, 21वीं शताब्दी की जो हम जीवन कौशल की बात करते हैं, तो वो क्या है? यू नो, वी वुड टॉक अबाउट कोलैबोरेशन, क्रिएटिविटी, वी वुड टॉक अबाउट एम्पैथी एंड अंडरस्टैंडिंग. क्या हम 21st सेंचुरी स्किल्स में ये चीज जान सकते हैं कि जिस माहौल में हम हैं, जो जिस सोसाइटी का हम हिस्सा है, वहां पे पितृसत्ता है, वहां पे हम पेट्रियार्की की जो हार्मफुल सोशल नॉर्म्स है उनको हमें क्वेश्चन करना है, वो क्यों जरूरी है, वो क्यों एक हमारे एक अच्छे और सुखद भविष्य के लिए, किसी भी बच्चे के लिए जरूरी है? क्योंकि एकेडमिक सब्जेक्ट्स आपको डेफिनेटली आपको प्रोफेशनली सक्सेसफुल बना देंगे, लेकिन अगर आपके पास वो लाइफ स्किल्स नहीं होंगी जो एक अच्छे रिश्ते के लिए जरूरी है, अगर आप समझ ही नहीं पाएंगे कि सहमति किसी भी रिश्ते में क्या मायने रखती है, अगर आप समझ ही नहीं पाएंगे कि एक दूसरे की सीमाओं को रिस्पेक्ट करना या फिर एक अच्छा वार्तालाप एक अच्छे रिश्ता कैसे बना सकता है, हाँ और ना कहने की समझ, ये सारी चीजें जो है, एम्पथी, अंडरस्टैंडिंग, इतनी जरूरी लाइफ स्किल्स हैं. And I think it is absolutely important कि हम ये सोच सकें कि जब हम 21st सेंचुरी लाइफ स्किल्स की बात करते हैं तो हम क्यों उसमें कॉम्प्रिहेंसिव सेक्शुअलिटी एजुकेशन को नहीं जोड़ते हैं. ऐसी क्या चीजें हैं जो हमें रोक रही हैं ये करने से? क्या हमें ये लगता है कि इससे यंग लोग ज्यादा सेक्स करने लगेंगे या फिर ये हमारे समाज के खिलाफ है? कौन तय करता है ये? और कहीं ना कहीं हमारे बच्चे जो एक्चुअली एक अच्छे जीवन की जो पहलू होता है उससे वो लोग वंचित रह जाएंगे.
दिस इज अ क्वेश्चन टू शिरीन जीजीबॉय. व्हाई डू यू थिंक इट इज इम्पोर्टेंट टू एंगेज विद यंग मेन एंड बॉयज अलोंग विद वुमेन एंड गर्ल्स व्हेन इट कम्स टू कॉन्ट्रासेप्टिव चॉइसेस, जेंडर डिस्क्रिमिनेशन, यू नो, अर्ली मैरिज एंड अदर इश्यूज रिलेटेड टू सेक्सुअल एंड रिप्रोडक्टिव हेल्थ एंड राइट्स?
As the previous speakers have said, you know, as things have been changing, the gap between menarche and marriage has increased. Young people are more exposed to education, to new ideas, to the media, and so on. And so one of those changes is very likely to be increased contraception, increased premarital sex. And I think the problem is that we must, as adults, put away our misconceptions and understand the needs of the young. So let me put this question in context. Currently, about 1 in 5 boys, just less than 1 in 10 girls report premarital sex before they're 20 from the available data. At the same time, over 1/4 of young women marry before they're 18 and many more marry in adolescence. So irrespective of whether we are considering the unmarried or the married, contraception among them tends to be very limited. And knowledge about contraception tends to also be limited. So among sexually active unmarried adolescents, hardly any may want to become pregnant. Yet less than 1 in 5 is using any method of protection, any method of contraception. And clearly this is exposing them to the risk of infection, to the risk of unwanted pregnancy. Among the married, many young couples want to delay or postpone their first pregnancy, but very few managed to do that. And the unmet need for contraception then is much higher among them. So whether or not they have sex is really not a question that should preoccupy us as adults. Rather, what's important is to know and to ensure that if and when it happens, it's informed, it's safe, and it's wanted. But there are, of course, many obstacles that young people face, from us as parents and from other adults in their lives.
All right. I'd like to ask a question to Trisha Shetty. Ma'am, you launched, She Says, in the year 2015, and we believe it's a platform that aims to educate, rehabilitate, empower women to take direct action against sexual assault in India. You know, in the last 5 years, have you been able to see any changes?
Yes, because for us, change is 2 steps forward, 5 steps back, 1 step forward, 2 steps back. But for the families that we work with on ground, even that 1 step forward means everything to them. We had a case of a child less than 10 years of age who had been raped. And it took us over 3 years of running from police stations to courtrooms and helping the family on ground to later get a 10-year conviction. Now, the law says these cases under the POCSO Act, which is Prevention of Sexual Abuse Against Children, must be tried within a year. But this is in a metropolitan city like Mumbai, where we just don't have the infrastructure. So you can imagine how bad it is in other rural pockets. It took over 3 years to get a guilty sentence. But 3 years later, we did get a 10-year conviction. So that makes all the difference for the family, because I distinctly remember what the father told me. He said, the person who raped my child had also sexually abused other kids, which I found out later. Had others reported him, my child would be safe. But now it ends with my child. He will not be in a position where he abuses other children. So it depends on the context, you know. Do things change? You don't do this work to get medals, awards, to see assured wins. You do this work and you show up every single day, because the most vulnerable and marginalized families show up. People from rich, upper-class societies don't show up to ask for justice. We still live under the burden of societal shame, ghar ki baat ghar pe rakho, log kya kahenge. It is the most poor who show up and fight for justice for all of us. So when they show up, we have a sense of obligation to also show up and fight. And you don't fight to win, you fight because you must. And just to put also things in context with the previous question you asked about sex education, how does it help? You know, if you live in Bombay, Mumbai, Delhi, you are very well living under the climate crisis repercussions, right? The climate has been the way we've never seen it before. The 2 most cost-effective solutions to fight the climate crisis is investing in young girls' education and sexual and reproductive healthcare rights, which is what we do as an organization. We go into schools, colleges, and teach all genders about consent, about their rights, how to take action should they be subject to some sort of abuse. Because in most cases, over 97% of cases of abuse, the abuser is known to the person. When it comes to child sexual abuse, it's over 99% of cases, the abuser is closely known to the person. It's not a stranger in a dark alley. So when abuse is happening within homes, who do you reach out to? Our families don't know how to report this. So this is why we need to strengthen infrastructure. And I'm really glad now governments, institutions, you know, press, media is talking about this in a way where our older generation never got to speak about these things. True. So I'm grateful for you, Amitabh, for, you know, NDTV, to have these conversations on mainstream channels, because only through more conversations will we change these cycles of oppression and abuse that we've been carrying on for generations.
Trishaji, I think you mentioned a lot of very important factors on the question that I asked. But one of the very concerning factors was the time it took for justice to prevail. A lot of people who go through this trauma are subjected to this time factor. And I'm, well, I don't know if it's okay to mention that, but you know, in the Nirbhaya case, the mother was continuously being called to justify in court on what happened to her daughter. And for many years, every odd 2 or 3 months, she has to go to court and to confirm that her daughter was raped. And she said, the actual rape of my daughter is not so bad as me having to go into court and say, yes, my daughter was raped. It's the most humiliating moment for any mother to be able to do that. And that is something that, you know, courts and justices need to be conscious of.
Tapsi, before you, Trisha, before you respond, I want to introduce Tapsi as a new co-host, a subject close to your heart. You've done movies on this. In fact, I have the two stars of the very famous. And you know, the point that Trisha was making, we need to be talking about this. So from a time where cinema used to glorify, I mean, this is the sad phase of Indian cinema also, where, you know, sexual oppression was glorified. Though obviously it was a message showing the reality. But now what is being highlighted is no means no. At least that's a start. Cinema is also playing its role. I believe you had a question for Trisha.
Hi, Trisha. I mean, I would love to hear what you to say regarding the question sir asked. Just in addition to this, we keep talking about what government and society system should do about this particular problem. I want to ask you, what can we do? All of us, what can we do in our daily lives to play a role in keeping our women safe? What can women do actually for each other? Let's start with ourselves first.
You know, thank you for bringing up Asha Devi. I remember meeting her, and she had come to Bombay when there was a gruesome rape that had happened in Unnao and Kathua. And she was getting back-to-back calls, you know, and at that point she was tired. And she told her husband, Badrinath, that I'm tired, you know, let me just take a break. And he said, no. Agar meri awaaz sunke logon ko tasalli milti, to I would talk. But they need to listen to your voice. So you speak now, you will rest later. And I asked her later, don't you get tired? How are you able to fight so much? And she said, yes, subah uthti hu, sangharsh karti hu, raat ko thak jati hu, soti hu, vapas subah uthti hu, sangharsh karti hu, kyunki main janti hu. What is the price my daughter has had to pay and I have had to pay? So it's this deep sense of responsibility to fight for justice from people who have seen the worst of humanity and still showcase the best of their own humanity. So what do we do? I think have these conversations. First, as women, as gender non-conforming people, own our truth and claim that, yes, this happened to me. And if someone listening, it makes them uncomfortable. You know, everyone loves to talk about gender equality. I'm so glad you are talking about the inequality, because you cannot fight for equality without addressing inequality. But when we talk about these things, they say, "Arey, it makes me uncomfortable." So it's okay if you're uncomfortable, if it means we will fight for truth and for this to change, for this reality to change. So one, have these honest conversations and hold our own family, hold the men in our own circles to higher standard. Two, as myself, as a woman, I've had to unlearn a lot of problematic behaviors. Things I thought were okay to say, things I thought were okay to do. We need to unlearn these things. And three, mainly, hold our elected leaders to account to do better by us. Hold our institutions accountable to provide us justice, to provide, to make sure we are safe, to make sure that the women's helpline number works across India, to make sure that streets have street lights on it, to make sure that, you know, when you walk down the street, you actually feel safe. We all know what that look is, the Tadna, we all know about it. To make sure, where is our money going? Is it being invested in the places? To make sure our education actually provides kids with the kind of quality education you need that will help you survive in this world. right? So I think these three simple things can do a lot. And if you have someone who reaches out to you and says they are being abused or they are not safe or they need help, don't ask them questions like, what did you do just before you got abused that may have justified you being abused? Tell them you are sorry. Ask them how you can help them. Connect them to a therapist and counselor, because mental health is so important for a survivor to get out of trauma and thrive. And beyond just justice, be there for them every day, because they carry the trauma for a long time.
You know, in addition to this, something that I strongly feel that needs to be done is to make sure the girl child gets good, right education right from the beginning. Because I think that is probably the root cause or a root solution rather to a lot of problems. So they are aware of what they can ask for, what they deserve.
Yeah.
And being mindful of this, just extending the answer to this, what I thought I should be doing rather than questioning and blaming a lot of people, is to make sure I can help in the education of a girl child. So I ended up adopting education, sponsoring education for girl children, in specifically those areas where child trafficking is extremely high.
Correct.
So I think this is one very, so to say, easy way of making difference. Yeah. At your level. Yeah. Just make sure you're imparting, you're helping a girl child get educated and imparting the right knowledge and education, so she knows in the future what she can expect and not expect.
Easy yet difficult. Yeah. Because there's so much more to be done. It's just the beginning.
It is just. Yeah. The beginning. But, all right, my next question for Prince Manvendra Gohil. When we talk of vulnerable communities, the LGBTQ community faces a huge challenge for shelter as well. Now, you have converted your ancestral place in Hanumanteshwar as a shelter home for LGBTQ community. It's called Queer Bag. I mean, I'm really, really nice name. Are you seeing more people coming after the legalization of Section 377 and even after COVID-19? And what are the challenges that you see?
See, I think one of the major challenges we have faced is, a lot of us were forced to live in our homes because, we had to all work from home, and that has given rise to a lot of marriage pressures coming from parents. And because most of us, we were to escape marriage pressures, we try to live socially independent away from families. And here we were forced to live with the families and parents, 24 hours, 24/7 harassment going on with them. And that led to a lot of mental health issues. So I have been dealing with a lot of counseling all throughout the pandemic, where, phone calls coming, the community wanting to leave the home. They're getting depressed. Some of them even were contemplating suicide, it went to that extent. So that was one of the major challenge. Another thing was those who were, below poverty line, we did manage to help them. We provided them ration kits, especially to the transgender community in the city of Vadodara, where we have a presence of my organization, Lakshya Trust, is there. And we managed to get help for them. For HIV, since we work for HIV positive people as well, we tried to provide them the treatment, the ART treatment at home. The government of Gujarat was very helpful and cooperative. We work for the government under the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare. So they also had tried to provide us a lot of help to see that the they continue taking the ART treatment, because you cannot stop the treatment, because it can have side effects, it can have other consequences. So I think these are some of the major challenges we have faced.
I have a question for Abhina Ahir. You know, you've been working for transgender rights for over two decades now, and so what are the kind of changes that you've seen, and what are some of the obstacles that have come your way?
Sir, sabse pehle dhanyavaad. Amit sir, you have been such a big torchbearer in Banega Swasth India, and I think you are transforming the entire universe, of course, India, but I think there's a lot of amplifier effect that is going to go to the other countries also, about showing how India is showing leadership from various fraternities. Sir, thank you for your question. I think we have been fighting for last two decades, more than two decades, on the transgender rights. You know our culture, you know how transgender people were always respected and they were given dignity and they were respected. Over the period of times, after the various invasions that has happened in India, transgender people have struggled a lot. And it took almost 70 years for us. In 2014, actually, first time the Supreme Court acknowledged us as a third gender. Before that, we were considered as males only, or trans men were considered as females only. We did not have even identity. Forget about identity card or any other related aspect. I think the biggest issue that we were struggling about, and we are still on sometimes we are struggling on, is inclusion. So I will give an example about it. So now you pick up any newspaper, any data, you will see, you will find the COVID cases, you will see how COVID has strongly impacted women. But you will not even find a smallest data on how many transgender people have been died because of COVID. How many transgender people have been affected because of COVID. We are still into the binary sectors and we need to deviate from that. We need to look into the third gender issues very, very seriously. I would like to also tell you, the people whom we always consider that they are begging on the streets and why they are doing that, these are the same people actually during the COVID difficult times were there on the streets with the police trying to impose the lockdown. They were the same people who were feeding their neighborhood from the same money that they have earned from the begging. So perspective of people has changed. I think by nature as Indian, we all have our fundamental rights, sir. We have right to education, we have right to employment, social welfare, good health, and at the same time dignity. And I think that has to be held for everybody. We are not talking about a small universe. If you look into the statistical data that are there about the transgender community, the latest mapping which was done on the transgender was in 2011, sir. As per that, there are 5 lakh transgender people and 55,000 transgender children between the age group of 0 to 6 years, sir. And now we are in 2021, sir. The statistical data of the gap of UNAIDS report talks about it, that in any developing country, sir, 1% of population will always be identifying as a transgender population. You consider our country, sir, it is 1.3 billion population. At least we are talking about a life of 15 lakh population. And my community is extremely impacted by the health aspect, because the transgender community is just not about hijras, but it is an umbrella term. We have transitioned from male to female, which is called as trans women. We have transitioned from female to male, which is called as trans men. We have religion-based identities like Jogti, Mangalmukti, Sivasakti, and we have other identities also. So when we talk about health aspect, because of the precarious condition of the tree, lot of our issues are sidelined and not been addressed appropriately. And this is a good opportunity for me to highlight that. Almost more than 4% of transgender people are living with HIV, because their sole income to survive is from begging, badai and sex work. So they are more and the vulnerable.
जी इतना मैं आपके पास वापस आऊंगा. इतना वास्ट सब्जेक्ट है और इसमें इतना कुछ है करने को कि वो समेटे नहीं समेटा जाता. तापसी,
सी द फोकस ऑफ द एनडीटीवी डेटॉल बनेगा स्वस्थ इंडिया सीजन दिस ईयर इज टू लीव नो वन बिहाइंड. सो कैन यू टेल मी हाउ कैन वी इंश्योर द कंप्लीट इंक्लूजन ऑफ द ट्रांसजेंडर कम्युनिटी.
I think the most important thing about it is that I think we have to focus on the sustainable development goal that we all countries are agreed to. When we talk about no one leaving behind, I think the most important aspect that we have to bring transgender into limelight. We have to give them, we have to put them seat when it comes to the policy. We have to create reservation for transgender people in various aspects. Transgender people are right now claiming various spaces. Transgender people are doctors, they are entrepreneurs, they are corporate social responsibility people. But vast population, almost 80% of transgender people are still surviving on begging and sex work.
sir, we still don't have opportunities. We still don't have equal spaces. I think I would not say equality, but I would say equity. Equity, because we are still living 100 years behind of the other people. And for that, we need to have a representation. We need to have representation in Bollywood. We need to have representation in corporate sector. And transgender people are not unintellectual people. It's a huge force. And even, sir, the World Bank report talks about it, that if you include LGBTI people and if you not exclude LGBTI people, there is a huge GDP loss, that will almost 1.7 billion loss that can cause to the Indian economy. And that's the published report. I feel important for us to talk about health for transgender people under Ayushman Bharat. We need to have infrastructure for transgender people, because right now in the medical fraternities don't know that when a transgender person is going to be undressed, what are they supposed to look into it? Medical curriculums are not supportive enough for transgender people. We need to bring that aspect into that. We need to have a special ward for transgender people right now. Even the gender neutral washrooms, sir. Even if you go to the such kind of facilities, and stigma at the healthcare facility is very, very high. Mostly the stigma is not done by the doctors. But you know, the moment I enter into the health facility, sir, right from the watchman to Aya to registration officer, everybody, and also the person who's standing next to me in the line, the kind of smirk and the kind of treatment that they give me while I'm accessing the transgender health.